Yeah. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this journal club. Arushi is my associate, and she will be talking about a paper on an interesting topic. You know, is there a change in one's approach to re-excision or conversion to mastectomy after a breast conserving surgery, in the light of doing or not doing oncoplasty with it? As you know, BCS has now become standard of care for T2 and less, and even for bigger ones after neoadjuvant therapy. There is a lot of debate across the world whether oncoplastic surgery should happen in the same sitting or at a later stage, and evidence is more and more strong now that it can be done at the same sitting. And many women across the world, may not be in India, but many women across the world prefer to have a retained body image in the form of an oncoplastic surgery in addition to breast conservation. Now, which one of these is better, to do the oncoplastic surgery straight away or whether you just want to do a BCS and wait and watch, particularly in the light of the need for conversion to either a re-excision or a mastectomy? That is the topic of this interesting paper. Over to you, Arushi.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, everybody. Welcome all to the journal club for today. The title is Rates of Re-excision and Conversion to Mastectomy After Breast Conservation Surgery With or Without Oncoplastic Surgery, a Nationwide Population Study. So this article was published in the British Journal of Surgery in the August 2020 issue. So as we all know, improved breast cancer survival rates have led to an increased focus on cosmetic outcomes after surgery. There is a very delicate balance between complete resection of the tumor with appropriate tumor margins versus a favorable cosmetic results. So a balance has to be achieved so we get the best of both. So oncoplastic surgery improves the cosmetic outcomes. Oncoplastic surgery, as we all know, by definition is the oncologic resection of a breast cancer with a subsequent breast reconstruction. So nowadays, it is used in up to 34% of the patients with breast cancer undergoing breast conserving surgery. And compared with the BCS, the oncoplastic surgery is associated with larger resections and a good long-term survival outcomes and quality of life. High quality evidence also suggests, high quality evidence regarding the impact of oncoplastic surgery on re-excision is sparse. So re-excision requiring mastectomy is defined as basically the surgery being converted to a mastectomy. Re-excision and conversion to mastectomy are usually associated with more morbidity, complications, poor aesthetic outcome, and a greater patient distress with increased healthcare cost. So the aim of this particular study was to compare re-excision rates after BCS versus the oncoplastic surgery in patients with early stage breast cancer in a population-based national setting. The secondary aim was to investigate whether the oncoplastic surgery results in a lower conversion to mastectomy rate compared with the breast-conserving surgery. So the method and materials involved in this particular study. So this was a Denmark-based study, and the Danish breast cancer database was the one from whom the data collection was done. The inclusion criteria were the women with invasive breast cancer without distant metastasis who underwent primary BCS, and patients who have received neoadjuvant chemotherapy or a surgical biopsy as the only surgical procedure were excluded from that particular data collection. Patients were subsequently categorized into four groups. The one with BCS, second group was the oncoplastic surgery in which volume displacement method was involved. The third group was the oncoplastic surgery in which volume reduction was involved. And fourth was the oncoplastic surgery with volume replacement method was involved.
Arushi, I'll stop you there. Just go back to the previous slide.
Yes, sir.
Indraja, what do these terms mean to you? OPS with volume displacement, with volume reduction and volume replacement.
Sir, in volume displacement, we'll remove the tumor and we'll locally reconstruct the breast, sir.
Okay.
In volume displacement,
Right.
and in volume reduction, there is a breast reduction, sir.
Okay. Reduction in the overall
Remove.
volume of the breast, but you accept it. Okay.
Yes, sir. And in volume replacement, we'll reconstruct the breast using the flaps,
Correct.
with the perforated flaps.
Correct. Very good. Yeah. Go on, Arushi.
So this study was a retrospective cohort study, and the time duration involved was a period of 6 years from January 2012 to December 2018. The outcomes measured were, the primary outcome was the chances of re-excision, which was defined as second BCS procedure or a mastectomy following the primary BCS within the 2 months of the initial operation. The secondary outcome studied was the conversion to mastectomy rate, CMR, which was defined as rate of mastectomy following the primary BCS within the 2 months of the initial operation. They followed the Danish guidelines, which is Denmark-based guidelines. So re-excision was advised if invasive carcinoma was identified at the INT margin or DCIS within 2 mm from the margin. Radiation in all patients younger than 50 years after BCS with or without oncoplastic surgery, and in those with a microscopic free margin of less than 2 mm for invasive breast carcinoma or DCIS, irrespective of age.
Again, Hari, what is the meaning of this inked margin? Are you there?
Hello, sir. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, what do they mean by say inked margin or within 2 mm of it?
Sir, the pathological margin, sir, from that excision margin, sir.
Yeah, when you give the specimen, you mark the you ink it, you know, and if you're within, if there is disease within 2 millimeters of it, then they would advise re-excision. Is that universally accepted or is it not? Particularly if there is DCIS.
They're not universally accepted, sir. It varies.
What is the alternative available, which is followed by other authorities, other guidelines or whatever?
Not sure, sir.
Think about it. What do you do after each BCS? What we follow here, mandatory after BCS versus a mastectomy where it is that phenomenon is not mandatory.
What is quad therapy, ma'am? Quad therapy. Veronesis quad therapy.
Go on, Ravi, tell them.
See, the this one was when you first introduced the breast conserving surgery, the principle was the fertile field theory, or if there is the subclinical or subradiological carcinoma in situ. So the entire field needed to be treated. So which is why if you do the mastectomy, obviously then you have taken out the entire breast tissue, so there is no issue of that. But if you are doing breast conserving surgery, so you want to prevent local recurrence. So to prevent local recurrence, Umberto Veronesi in Milan, started this treatment called quad therapy, which is quadrantectomy and radiotherapy. So after you have done the quadrantectomy, you give radiotherapy to that breast, and if you have not addressed the axilla, to the axilla as well. If you have addressed the axilla, then you treat the axilla as it has been treated properly. So that is what sir was meaning.
Yeah.
Okay.
Radiotherapy. Okay? Yeah. Go on, Arushi.
Yes, sir.
Sir, just a minute. This inking of the, do you do inking? Because I just put stitches to all margins. I
Yeah.
don't ink.
I don't think either.
So, but I think inking means, I think the pathologist inking it.
It could be the pathologist inking it also. Yes.
Because I have not seen
Yeah.
any surgeon inking it. I think it
Correct.
will be pathologist.
Yeah. Yeah. I also do only sutures to orient the specimen, that's all.
Yeah.
Yeah. Go on, Arushi.
Yes. So in this particular study, they had involved a numerous number of tests in which patient and tumor characteristics were compared between BCS and OPS, the oncoplastic group, using the chi-square test for categorical variables. For the continuous variables, they use the Mann-Whitney U-test or Kruskal-Wallis test, which are non-parametric tests basically. And a two-sided p-value of less than 0.05 was considered statistically significant. To adjust for confounders, a multivariable logistic regression model was also used. So the analysis was repeated in propensity score match cohorts after the results were collected, and they evaluated whether associations were subject to confounding by indication or not. All analysis were subsequently performed using the SPSS version 24 statistic program.
Just go back one bit. We have talked about propensity score matching. Janani, can you tell us whether you remember what we have said about it in the past, or you know what it means? Just the principle.
Can you hear me, sir?
Yes, hello? I can.
Okay. Sir, it is a tool to come to an interference between two different variables, sir.
Mm-hmm.
So we do it for the common variables between the two groups.
Yes. What kind of studies would you apply a propensity score matching in? RCTs, prospective studies, retrospective studies. Where would you use it?
In RCTs, we use it, sir.
You have to read up again. Anis Sadiq is a name I see here. Anis, unmute. Tell us where you are from and can you answer that question? Anis, are you there? Not there. I am trying to see involve people other than from Sagar.
Yeah.
Not having too much luck with it. Kavya, you're from Sagar. Are you the new registrar, Kavya?
Yes, sir.
Well, let me see you. Get your video going. Welcome. I only heard about you. I have not met you. Very nice. So can you tell us what it is, Kavya?
Sir, it is used in observational data, like in
prospective or retrospective?
Retrospective, sir.
Correct. It is done only in retrospective studies where you have so many variables, you want to know if there are confounding variables and to, you know, that there you have limited control on the data. So to reduce and minimize the confounding variables, you use the multiple regression, you know, logistic regression on different pairs of possible confounding factors. And then you choose a particular part of that cohort where the two groups are matched. That way you aim to reduce the bias, selection bias. Ramakrishna, you have anything else to add on that?
Yes, sir, what you said is correct. The thing is, they will match each patient in one group to another patient in the other group with various scores. So for example, if tumor size is 2 centimeter in one patient, they will choose one more patient from the other group who also has got 2 centimeter size. If he has 4 centimeter, there is no point in comparing them. So like that, they choose so many variables, and for each variable, they will see that there is a match, and then only they will select. If he doesn't match with anyone else, then that patient data is deleted. Yeah. It is not considered.
Yeah.
So that is the score, propensity score. So score should match for each patient in this group versus the other group.
Yeah, good.
What is the disadvantage, can anyone say, about propensity score matching? Hari?
Sir, makes the sample less.
You lose a lot of data.
A lot of patients.
You can lose a lot of data if there is no comparative, as Dr. Ramakrishna said very clearly.
But when you do it on these national registries,
yeah,
remember we had that in a Japanese national registry about anticoagulants, for example.
Yeah.
So when you have that, you even if you lose many,
you still have a lot of
data points. You still have a lot of them left. Okay. Okay. Can we come
Arushi,
to the? Go on, Ravi. Go on.
Ravi. Arushi, can you please go back to the statistics?
Yes, sir.
Can you please highlight what is Kruskal-Wallis test? Because I have not heard of it.
Yes, sir. So it's also called as ANOVA test, sir.
ANOVA.
The ANOVA. So it's
ANO
a
is, oh,
this
ANO,
is
I know
a
ANOVA.
non-parametric test, sir. It is for categorical the continuous variables.
I didn't know that ANOVA was called Kruskal-Wallis test.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. Okay.
All right. Can we come to the critique, please? Yeah. Students first. Pavan.
Sir, am I audible, sir?
Yes, you are.
Sir, first of all, the fast for this study, sir.
Sorry?
The far for this study, sir.
Yeah, the good points. Good points of the study. Go ahead. Yeah.
Sir, this is a recent study, sir.
Yeah.
It is published in 2021.
Yeah.
And
2020. Yeah.
20, yes, sir. And it is published in British Journal, having good impact factor, sir.
Okay.
And it is a relevant topic, sir.
Good. Good research question. Relevant topic. Yes.
And propensity score matching is used so that they can able to compare the variables what they want
okay.
to compare.
They are able to, yeah, not can able to, they are able to compare.
Yes, sir.
And they have to some extent, to a large extent, accounted for confounding factors. Yes.
Yes.
All right. Anis, are you connected now? Unmute yourself and talk to us, please.
Doesn't look like he is, because one participant is less. It may be him.
Okay. It says Anis is here. Okay. Anyway. Tanvir, are you connected? Unmute.
Hello. Yes, sir.
Yeah, go on. Tell me, what are the good and not so good points about this study up to this point? That is research question and methodology.
The good point was that they have done extensive statistical analysis for that.
Okay.
They have used multiple different statistical models.
Mm-hmm.
So that actually decreases the, if one has a certain drawback of any one study, if one analytical process, then that is synchronized by the other.
No, do you think that these statistical things are measuring the same thing in different ways? Only then it can compensate the way you describe it. It is not. Different aspects of the data are correctly, they have to be tested by different kinds of statistical tests, and they have used it. Okay, so it's not that if one test misses something, the other one will make up for it. Go ahead, next one. What do you think of the numbers? Do you think there are good numbers in the study? Are you there or have you disconnected? Okay, some technical problem. All right, Hari, go on.
Sir, other than what Pavan has said, sir.
Yeah, always. Don't repeat. Yeah, go on.
Definitions about the thing they have classified, like what are the patients like BCS, for the patients who
they have defined the cohorts.
Cohorts,
very good.
Yes,
very good. Yeah. Okay. Next point. So. Correct. That's correct.
Then, and also, sir, this is a nationwide study, sir. So numbers
okay.
are good.
Large numbers and so representative of the population.
Of course,
good.
Sir. Not like single study. So it's
all right. Right.
So for against this study, sir. Can I
some more for? What else would you look at in the materials and methods? You look at the inclusion exclusion criteria, right? Are they reasonable or they're not reasonable?
Yes, sir. The criteria are reasonable, sir. And also they made for more than 50 years and patients. Again, they have made some analysis and particularly they made post-matching analysis also. Rematching, post-matching analysis also.
We'll discuss that later. You know, I think there is a question mark on that. Okay, tell me your not so good points.
Not so good point, sir. Obviously, it's not an RCT, sir. So, okay. Prospective study can be there.
Yeah.
So, regarding that tumor margin, you are asking, sir, 2 centimeter ink. So, is it like definition what they followed and what is that? Who decides the type of surgery, surgeon choices, or what details about it? What some more details could be there. So, that was
missing. Right. Agreed.
So, and the matching, actually the propensity matching was there, but I don't know whether it is correct, but the patients in the oncoplastic group is less. That was the matching was correct or not, I don't know.
So all right, we'll go to the seniors now. Ravi, anything else that you would like to add to what the boys have said? Unmute, please.
I think they have covered most of it.
All right. Ramakrishna?
Say one thing. What are the indications for doing OPS and BCS? That is not very clearly defined there, sir.
Yeah.
Because they are comparing these two.
Yeah.
That point is very important.
Yeah. Yeah. And Nishant have mentioned it. Yes. Yes.
Which one, sir?
This point Nishant has mentioned and Hari also mentioned it. Who decides what surgery and when? You know, that is something that they have not specified. You're right. Okay. Anything else?
No, what I was trying to tell is, if a particular patient goes for only BCS, means if they have predefined criteria to say this patient should go for BCS, this patient should go for OPS, then there is no point in comparing those two.
Yeah.
Because it is mutually exclusive. Then we cannot compare it. So before that, the same type of patient, if they can go for either case, then they can be compared.
Yeah.
That indication has to be defined properly.
Right. My reading of this, that's a very valid point, I agree. But my reading was that the definition of BCS is there.
Yeah.
I'm sure the daily guidelines will say T2 and less. Because they excluded the, if it were more than T3, they would give them new adjuvant and then do it, and the new adjuvant were excluded. So that definition is there, but the need for, from then on you can leave it at BCS or you can go for OPS. That I think was left to the surgeon's expertise and the patient's demand, patient's choice. So based on that, it was a retrospective study. So that kind of selection, there is no difference in indication for BCS alone or for BCS plus OPS.
Correct.
That is the underlying principle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I agree.
Yeah.
Because BCS guidelines are there already.
Yeah. Yeah. Niranjan, anything? Niranjan, are you there?
Yes, sir. Nothing.
Go on. Nothing else. Okay, Arushi, please go ahead. Nishant, you have anything else to say other than what you put in the box?
No, sir. I think you brought up the point about that expertise.
Yeah.
Probably OPS was done only by the people who had more expertise, which could explain the better results. So I'm not very sure.
That's right. Yeah. Go on. Arushi, please list
sir,
what you have put
sir,
up. Yeah.
Can I just come?
Yeah, please.
See, the thing is now, I don't know. I think the timing of the study now across Europe, I can talk from extrapolation of what is happening in England.
Yeah.
That the surgeries are now done exclusively in, oncoplastic centers.
Yeah.
So I don't think expertise of the group is particularly in question, because everybody is, unless the situation is different in Denmark.
No. Even in the UK, even now, Ravi, people are having BCS across the country. So
yeah.
If somebody wants OPS, oncoplasty, then they have to go to the designated center. So that becomes the patient's choice.
So almost every hospital has an oncoplastic surgeon.
Well, if that is the case, then it's different. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. In Denmark, that doesn't seem to be the case.
Maybe. Yeah.
Go on, Arushi. We'll
yes,
list
sir.
What we have put up. Yeah.
So this is the critique apart from what is mentioned already. So it was a relevant topic. The positives for this study was, it was a good journal, a British journal, with an impact factor of 6.36. And it's a recent paper, and the need of the study has been mentioned, which is also relevant. And it also is a large database collection. The negatives is that it's a retrospective cohort. So the level of evidence is particularly slightly lower than a RCT. Recurrence rate specifically, they have not addressed in this particular article. Only the re-excision rates have been mentioned.
Yeah.
And a follow-up of only 2 months was addressed, actually.
Yeah. You know, it's not just a follow-up. See, one of the other main issues in any BCS is the recurrence rate and the overall survival rate. Okay? That question was not asked at all in this paper. And it seems to me that their only goal, because they restricted the study to people who had repeat surgery in 2 months' time, as short as 2 months, their only goal was to see what would be the so-called inadequate excision rate, either because of BCS or because of BCS plus OPS. To that extent, I felt that there is limited applicability of this research question. It is undoubtedly a good research question, but it has a great limitation because we will keep thinking, what is the recurrence rate of these people, say, 1 year or 2 years later? And that is another question that has to be answered, but that question itself is not asked in this paper. Any comments on that? All right, go ahead, Arushi.
Yes. So now moving on to the results of this article. So a total of 18,188 patients met the inclusion criteria and were included in the study, of whom 13,185, which is 72.5%, underwent breast conservation surgery, and the rest, 27.5%, underwent oncoplastic surgery. So this particular table suggests the various baseline characteristics of patient demographics. This is what was the relevance finding from it. So age of the patients who underwent BCS were older than that of the oncoplastic group, 62 years in BCS study versus the 59.9 years in the oncoplastic group. Patients who underwent the oncoplastic surgery had a lower comorbidity score versus the ones who were in the BCS category. The oncoplastic surgery group had poorer prognostic marker, which means that they had incorporated the higher differentiation grade, larger tumor size, and more lymph nodes. The significance of this is P of less than 0.001. This next particular table shows only the oncoplastic group, oncoplastic surgery. So the type of oncoplastic surgery, they have divided amongst the various population. Overall, there is a decrease in overall use if we compare with the year. So in the year of 2012, there was 30.3% who underwent oncoplastic surgery versus the ones in 2018 to a decrease of 26.4%. A p-value of less than 0.001 was calculated. The volume displacement group had 83.4%, volume reduction had 13.6%, and a volume replacement group had 3.1%. So very less in the volume replacement group. A volume reduction or the volume replacement had a lower comorbidity score compared to a volume displacement group. This last particular study, it depends on the univariable or the multivariable analysis which they have underwent over the various groups. So the inference is, in the multivariable analysis which they used, the patients who underwent the oncoplastic surgery were less likely to undergo a re-excision than those who had a breast conservation surgery. In this, the adjusted odds ratio was 0.8 with a 95% of confidence interval. So the other results from the study were that in total, 2,763 patients underwent re-excision, in whom the final surgical treatment was a breast conservation surgery in 2,100 patients, which is 76.3% versus 23.7% in the mastectomy group. So the re-excision rate was calculated to be 15.6% for patients who underwent BCS versus 14.1% among those who had oncoplastic. The p-value was 0.012. The re-excision rates varied according to the oncoplastic technique. So 14.5% was for the volume displacement group, with 10.3% for the volume reduction, and 20.9% for the volume replacement group. So in total, they calculated the conversion to mastectomy, which was performed in 3.6% of the total population, which was studied in this. The CMR, the conversion to mastectomy rate, was 3.7% after the BCS group and 3.2% after the oncoplastic group. There was different CMR which was observed amongst the various techniques which were involved in the oncoplastic group. So 3.2% for the volume displacement, 2.9% for the volume reduction, and 5.9% for the volume replacement group. The patients who underwent the oncoplastic surgery were less likely to undergo conversion to mastectomy than those who had BCS. However, the results were very small. The difference was very small, actually. Conversion to mastectomy was more likely in patients with poor prognostic characteristics. So coming to the discussion now. So re-excision or conversion to mastectomy was less likely among
one patients. One sec, Arushi.
Yes, sir.
The question by Nishant, what is the comorbidity score?
Sir, they have used the Charlson comorbidity score, in which the various comorbid conditions such as diabetes, hypertension, the ischemic heart disease, they have incorporated. Yeah. They have calculated a score according to that.
Right. Yeah. Are you asking for the critique after the discussion, or is it after the results? After the discussion.
Yes.
Arushi, what do you mean by the odds ratio being 0.8 with the 95% confidence interval? Can you elaborate on that?
Yes, sir. So odds ratio basically means what are the odds of a particular... I'll just go back to that slide. Yes, sir. So what are the odds of that particular result versus the other results? So in a usual statistics, we take confidence interval of 95%. In that, the p-value comes to be 0.05. That is the usual, sir.
Yeah.
My simple question, if the odds ratio is 1, what does it mean to you?
It's equal.
Sorry?
It's not significant, sir. It's
there is no difference between the two groups.
The two groups. So here, one group is less. 0.80 means one group has less chance of mastectomy compared to the
other group. The other group is taken as 1, this fellow is 0.8. So if it is 0.6, it's even better. You know, it's like that. The farther this figure is away from the figure of 1, there is a bigger is the difference between the two groups.
It could be also 2.45 or 3.
Yeah. I mean, it could be either more or less. Either way, the farther it is away from 1, it means that the difference is more. If it is less than 1, it means the occurrence is less frequent. If it's more than 1, the occurrence is more often. Okay? That is the meaning of odds ratio.
Yeah. Arushi, can you also explain why the mastectomy rates are higher with the volume replacement group?
Think about it. Just common sense.
It's very simple.
Because we have taken a flap in a volume replacement group, sir.
Yeah, sure. But why should it be the conversion rates are higher in that?
Chances of...
There was one hint you yourself mentioned. In the replacement group, they seem to have larger tumors.
Yes.
Okay. On a similar vein, what are the other possibilities?
The more comorbidities.
No.
The tumor characteristics.
Factors,
correct. Ravi, you had something else to add?
The tumor size with respect to the normal breast volume may be, such that there is significant reduction in the breast size. So, which to compensate for that, they would have had to use the
replacement.
Probably that is the reason.
All right, go to discussion, Arushi. Yeah.
Yes, sir. So, starting with discussion, the re-excision or conversion to mastectomy was less likely among patients who underwent the oncoplastic surgery than the breast conservation surgery. However, there were very modest differences. The current evidence regarding the impact of oncoplastic surgery on the re-excision rate is limited. boost radiation, which is associated with serious side effects. So re-excision may have been preferred over boost radiation, especially in patients with tumor bed in front of heart. The present overall re-excision rate in this particular study is 15.2%, which is comparable and within the range reported in other studies, wherein they have reported it as 0 to 15.7%. The overall conversion to mastectomy rate in this particular study was 3.6%, which is well below the mean of 6.2% and within the range of 0 to 34.2% reported in previous studies. So this particular article also mentions about its limitations, which says that information of the potential confounders such as breast size, the smoking status, the surgeon's preference, the levels of experience were not available. Also, the rationale behind the choice of specific surgical technique was not registered by the database which from where the data was collected. Conclusion. So this study emphasizes the appropriate use of the oncoplastic surgery in selected patients who would otherwise would not be eligible for breast conservation.
All right. Before the critic, Nishant has a question. Is there a significant number like a p-value for odds ratio? The confidence interval itself is the equivalent of a p-value for odds ratio.
Yes, it's 95%.
Okay? Yeah, with 95% in the calculation of the odds ratio, if they say I have a confidence interval of 95%, it is equivalent. It's like saying that is it. We have taken 0.05 as the significant value. What is boost radiation, and whom was it given to?
So boost radiation is basically the radiation given after the therapy, so BCS with the
after the surgery.
Surgery.
Yes.
They have given it to them.
Yes.
To prevent recurrence, or when they have found there is a.
Did they give it to them in this trial?
Yes, sir.
No.
They have not included that
one. Not included, Allama. That in fact, it was one of the points I was going to raise. It looks like in the Danish guidelines they do not routinely give radiotherapy after BCS. Which is quite surprising to me. In fact, I was going to discuss it later, but Nishant has already asked for this. It looks from this paper that the Danish guidelines do not insist on boost radiotherapy. It looks like nobody gets it, which is very unusual.
Can I come in, sir?
Yeah.
I just looked up boost radiation. They say is it is an extra dose of radiation apart from the radiotherapy which is given for BCS.
Yes, sir.
And this is given as a concentrated radiation only to the site of the tumor bed. The normal radiotherapy is to the entire chest.
But that, if you look at this paper, they never mentioned about radiotherapy as a part of the protocol.
Sir. And they've only said boost radiation, and they've said it was indicated for people who are less than 50, probably to counter for the aggressiveness.
So are you suggesting that they apply only, this is applying to only to the concentrated radiotherapy?
Yes, I think it is.
Maybe, but it was not very clear.
Yeah, they have not given the clear-cut idea about what exactly.
All right. In fact, I was going to say, how come they have not mentioned about DXT at all? But maybe they presume that it is done according to their guidelines. Point taken. Go on.
Yes,
any other critique?
Sir, can I just ask you, this is a general question.
Yeah.
See, I know it's difficult for us to, so because we don't do the... You know, for example, plastic surgery, you know, the cosmetic result.
Yeah.
How many of your BCS, you after, you know, maybe an year follow-up, I think there is so much of, the remodeling of the breast that you hardly actually make out that the patient has had a, BCS. Don't you think?
This is a very, very interesting point. Actual fact, I discuss oncoplastic surgery with every single patient of mine who has a BCS. And you won't believe it, even one of them hasn't asked for it now.
Correct.
If they did, I would definitely get a plastic surgeon involved and then get the thing done. But nobody seems to, it depends on the way you talk about it, I suppose.
No, but
and particularly when you talk about the costs involved in oncoplastic surgery, most of them say, I don't care about it.
Yeah, sure. That is one point. The other point is, I know we have not done cosmetic scoring and all those things. But just naked eyeballing of the breast, maybe 6 months or 1 year down the line,
yeah,
how much of them, you see there is a significant, sort of a dent or a, very ugly kind of thing?
Well, it depends on the tumor breast volume ratio.
Yeah.
If you have a small tumor in a big breast, nobody sees anything. But if it's the other way around, then there will be a definite distinct asymmetry.
Of course. But then in those people, you may not necessarily do BCS. You may do a mastectomy because...
We can offer that also. Yeah. Any other comments? Nishant, you want to say anything about it?
So this breast dispersion is, they use, the fat globules or something to augment the breast. What is that they do?
No, in this particular paper, as far as I know, it is flaps.
No,
I don't think they've talked about, the displacement is rotation flaps, perhaps.
Okay.
In the local area rather than, a distant flap.
Okay.
Yeah. They haven't exactly specified what they do.
Nothing else to add, sir.
All right, Ramakrishna.
Sir, in that table she showed, that I think table number 1 or something, they have compared these two in a tabular form, and everywhere they have mentioned a p-value significant. That means the difference between BCS group and OPS group as far as this age, tumor, HER2 receptor, and then all those criteria are concerned. When they are not comparable, how to give this odds ratio, compare those two and say one is superior to other? Because there is significant difference in the demographics and the confounding factors, as p-value suggests. Then these two groups cannot be compared. How they can compare these two? The propensity score is applied to see that these two groups become comparable. After propensity score matching, the p-value should come less than 0.05. That is, it should become not significant.
Yeah.
That table they have not shown at all.
Yeah, the way I read it, I took their statement at face value that this was the original thing, and after propensity score, they have compared only the post propensity score cohorts.
That is not there, sir.
Not specifically mentioned.
Article, no. Post propensity. See, initially, if they start with something like 18,000, after propensity score matching, the number should be equal in each group because each patient is matched with the other patient.
Correct.
1:1 means if 3,000 is there in this group, the other group also should have 3,000.
Correct.
If they are 1:2, then it can be 3,000 versus 6,000. Then we can apply statistics.
Right.
But the difference is too much, and that table shows it is a lot of difference as far as all those confounding variables what they have mentioned. When there are so much of difference in the variables, how can they compare and say one is better than the other?
Yeah, I mean, point taken. I presume because I would expect the peer reviewers to have picked it up, and still they have allowed it through, and so there may be an issue. This may call for another letter to the BJS from you, Ramakrishna.
Yeah.
Seriously,
it's
I mean,
old,
it's
sir now. More than 1 year old.
No, it
more
doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. You can say that we did the journal club now, and that's why I'm mentioning it. It really is an important point because we need to see the post propensity score cohort. That is the point you're making. Yeah, I agreed completely. Yeah. Any other critique? Ravi?
No, I think you already brought it up, sir.
I
think the more relevant thing for you to apply it across the board would have been to look at the recurrence rates, which has not been done. But I think they were probably addressing a very narrow question, I think.
Yeah. Arushi, just proceed, please.
Yes, sir. So the positives for this particular after the results and discussion, the statistical analysis have been appropriately applied. The propensity score matching has been used. The statistics are fairly reasonable, and the discussion and conclusion is relevant, particularly to the study.
Arushi, what is reasonable statistics? I think it is either correct or not correct. There is nothing called reasonable statistics because statistics is a very specific tool. So you have to apply the appropriate statistics, as sir said, to the appropriate situations. For example, if you are comparing, you know, the parametric data, you have to apply the appropriate statistics, the non-parametric data for multi-regression variation, and then put looking at the longevity of the patient. So it has to be specific. So there is nothing called reasonable statistics.
Yes, sir. So it's appropriate statistics, yeah, because they have applied the correct one for the correct data. The negatives for this study, the tumor margin data is inadequate. Particularly, they have not mentioned how much margin they have taken. Very few number in the volume replacement group, and also the differences between the BCS and OPS group, as previously mentioned, is small.
Hello.
Yeah. Go on, sir.
In that article, have they mentioned anything in their conclusion?
The same thing, sir. They said that it needs is more emphasis.
No. What I asked is there a conclusion in that article? I didn't see that.
The heading of conclusion is not there.
Is not
but,
there. Yeah. We have to derive our own conclusion after reading all these things.
Yeah.
They have not given any proper solid conclusion. At the end, they say OPS may be used, may not be. We don't recommend OPS. That way, they have mentioned some.
Yes, sir. So they have said that they do not support the use basically in all the patients, and they emphasize the appropriate use of the oncoplastic surgery in selected patients.
See, they with the statistics, they are showing that the re-excision rate is less in OPS group. And then they say, we don't recommend OPS. How does it correlate with
how does it gel? The fact is that the differences are very small. Okay. And the cohort is very, very diverse. It's not a, you know, it's across the country, various. Even though they have tried to reduce the confounding variables, it is really a very diverse group, and so they are not able to give a very strong, clear message at the end of this study. Okay, and as I said, the biggest drawback in my mind is that it doesn't talk about long-term recurrence. That's what really everybody matters, you know, everybody thinks about. When you have a BCS, is it going to affect your overall survival and longevity and complication rate? That has not been addressed at all. Okay. You have any more slides? You have
no,
done
sir,
any collateral
right.
reading? Is that the end?
Yes, sir. That's
all right. So, comments from people, students. You want to start first? Pavan, what have you to say about this paper? There are two questions we always ask at the end of.
Yes.
The study. What are those two questions?
Whether this study can be applied to our day-to-day life.
Correct. What is the second question? Would you change your day-to-day practice based on the results of this study? Those are the two questions that we ask. So, what is your answer to these two questions?
Actually, they are not specifying that.
What are your answers? What is your take-home message from this paper on these two questions? Are these data applicable to our patients?
No, sir.
Why not?
Because people are not accepting the because of cost issue or.
Okay, not great. No great demand for OPS.
Yes,
point taken. And they don't also seem to worry too much about the mastectomy, and they don't seem to be too, you know, bent on getting a BCS. Okay, that's one. Second, are you going to change your practice based on this? Ramakrishna sir has already answered that indirectly.
Yes, sir. We are not going to change that, sir. We are.
Why? You just have to rephrase Dr. Ramakrishna's statement. The data is not strong enough, not robust enough for us to do anything different. Okay?
Yes, sir.
All right. Kavya, you have any comments?
No, sir.
Right. Nishant?
No comments, sir. Nothing to add.
Niranjan?
Nothing to add, sir.
Okay. Only thing they should have been more clear about radiotherapy post-op protocol.
Yeah, protocol. That's
recurrence.
Yeah, yeah. Ramakrishna.
Yeah, she presented very well, sir. It is really very well. She has done very good job, but they have done this extensive statistics, collected data, taken so much of pain, and in the end, there is no one solid recommendation or guideline what to be done for us. At the most, we can use it for a as a what we can say to support one RCT, which should compare these two, considering the recurrence rate and the re-excision rate, all those things. We can have a RCT.
Yeah.
To support RCT, we can use this data. Otherwise, not for practice.
Yeah. Ravi?
I think I do agree with Dr. Ramakrishna, but still sometimes, as we say, that you know, all studies need not come out with results that are startling or very different. And I think they have been honest about what they have recommended. So I think you have to appreciate them for that. And I think we can take this forward and say, well, if at all we are doing a study, that we can try and see if we can apply this for a randomized control in a prospective study.
All right. My final comments, Arushi, I think your presentation was very good, but you must come up with collateral reading. A part of the journal club is not just to analyze what is given in that given paper. You must do collateral reading, look at other reviews, other data, even perhaps you have RCTs about this. I must confess that I usually look up for these collateral reading, but I didn't do it for this particular paper. So you must look at collateral reading and give the views so that we get a comparison as to whether it is the same views as this paper or whether are different views. Okay, that is an important thing. The next thing is to make a comment, a general comment, that a paper like this is ideal for journal club because it gives us a lot of food for thought, and when we all have these collective discussions, we collectively learn a lot about general practice of surgery. And I agree with the consensus here that this particular, the results or conclusions of this paper would not lead to any change in practice that we are already doing.
Yes, sir.
Okay? Yeah. Thank you very much. Good night, and thank you for joining this meeting.
Sir, there is a hot news. I know you may already...
Can I stop the recording?
Yeah.